Somewhere far away within the uncharted ancient mountains of eastern Siberia, there is a dull warehouse-style building with train tracks that make their way inside. It is the entrance to the Severomuysky railway tunnel. A little less than 10 miles long, its numbers aren't remarkable to the outer world standards, though every inch of that tunnel bored through tough, icy ground, fragile crumbling rock, and the frightening obscurity of the previously unspoiled mountains was defeated by a truly superhuman effort. And what's worse, the Soviets had to work on this tunnel on their own. No one in the world had the guts to help them. In the early 1980s, when the construction first started, the tunneling industry had already made a lot of progress. Engineers were able to freeze boiling underground thermal waters and knew how to treat concrete laid down in permafrost. They had the technology to break through dangerous geological faults, which were filled with granite that was crushed into quicksand by strong and frequent earthquakes. World-leading tunneling companies were very happy to sell their ultimate generation machines to the Soviets, who only disposed of an old tunneling shield that remained from the Moscow metro construction in 1936. What Western businesses did not agree to on any terms was to send their employees to operate these machines. Drilled galleries in the Severomuysky tunnel construction site had a very high concentration of radioactive radon gas, 10 times the maximum permissible rate. 2 million gallons of groundwater, saturated with radon, infiltrate the tunnel every hour, and flowing down the drainage channels, release the dangerous substance into the air. Even today, the ventilation system is not capable of removing radon from the tunnel atmosphere. People who have to work there call their small hazard pay the coffin money. Their job is simple, but very important. A few times a week, all train traffic stops, and a specially equipped rail car enters the tunnel. Workers take their shovels and start knocking down icicles that form on the walls and the ceiling of the tunnel. Each trip results in about 200 cubic feet of radon water icicles being knocked down. This is the cold reality of running trains across the eastern Siberian mountains. The Severomuysky tunnel is constantly warmed up with electric heaters totaling 4 megawatts of power. The tunnel has doors that are computer controlled and are opened only when a train is approaching. The doors are made of a lightweight material so that a locomotive could safely knock them down in case the computer fails. But the outside temperatures reach negative 40 degrees, and long freight trains arrive so cold that they manage to freeze the middle section of the tunnel just by passing through. Despite its Siberian lumberjack brutality, the Severomuysky Tunnel is a complicated piece of engineering art. The tunneling industry owes thanks for a number of innovative construction technologies, the most important of which is chemical grouting. The rock through which the tunnel had been bored was so loose that they had to drill wells and pour cement silica, clay cement, and various chemical polymers that, upon hardening, turned sand into stone. But no man-made chemical compound can sustain the weight of a mountain, and the tunnel itself is a multi-layered structure. Reinforced in situ concrete lining, cast iron tubing, more concrete. Through the Ungarakan Depression, where an enormous collapse killed 31 workers, the final lining of the main tunnel comprises 1 meter thick compartments of concrete-filled steel case panels with pre-installed rebar. This is not some Gotthard base tunnel where they put waterproof panels on Velcro straps. This is a design that sustains multiple 4 to 5 point earthquakes per month, and even if there are more coming, it will be well prepared. And all that endless, unequal battle with nature, and all the effort of the brave people who chose to live in a remote taiga settlement and fix computer errors with a shovel is just for 15 trains per day. The Baikal-Amur mainline railway, which goes through the tunnel, is a single-track railway and can provide only so much capacity. Only by pure luck, a series of fortunate events found a use for this road that was initially built for image and military purposes. And a project of making it two-track throughout its entire length is currently in progress. The construction of the second Severomuysky tunnel is inevitable. Its cost has been estimated at $3 billion, and the Siberian Anthracite Coal Mining Company is willing to cover it fully in exchange for priority access. That's how profitable this industry is. Others propose a detour construction, be it 100 or 200 miles, does not matter, they say. The construction of the first Severomuysky tunnel was a 25-year-old nightmare. And even half a century later, we still can't be sure that our success can be repeated. One thing is certain. We live in the happiest times, because in only a few years, we'll see this decision being made and implemented.